Lord, More home and shall with your glory. For I know my lawlessness and my sin is always before me. Against you only have I sinned and done evil in your sight, that you may be justified in your words and overcome when you are judged. For behold, I was conceived in transgressions, and in sins my mother bore me. Behold, you love truth. You showed me the unknown and secret things of your wisdom. You shall sprinkle me with hyssop, and I will be cleansed. You shall wash me, and I will be made whiter than snow. You shall make me hear joy and gladness. My bones that were humbled shall greatly rejoice. Turn your face from my sins and blot out all my transgressions. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with your guiding spirit. I will teach transgressors your ways, and the ungodly shall turn back to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall greatly rejoice in your righteousness. O Lord, you shall open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For if you desired sacrifice, I would give it. You will not be pleased with whole burnt offerings. A sacrifice to God is a broken spirit. A broken and humbled heart God will not despise. Do good, O Lord, in your good pleasure to Zion, and let the walls of Jerusalem be built. Then you will be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then shall they offer young bulls on your altar.
Glory to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, at the intercession of the apostles, O Lord, have mercy, Lord, on many offenses. O now and ever, and to the ages of ages, amen, at the intercession of Theotokos, O Lord, of mercy, Lord, by many offenses.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your great mercy, and according to the abundance of your compassion, blot out my transgression. O God, wonder sanctified with your life.
Yeah.
I consider
Love.
Blessed is the kingdom of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, now and forever, to the ages of ages.
Amen.
Peace, let us pray for the Lord.
Thank you.
that you shall declare your wonders, O Lord, and your truth in the church of the saints. You were transfigured on the mountain, O Christ God, showing to your disciples your glory as much as they could bear. Shine upon us also, sinners, with your light everlasting, through the intercessions of the Theotokos, O giver of life. Glory to you.
You were transfigured.
Makarios o laos o ginoskos alalamon.
Metemorphotis eduri Christeo Theos. Dixos dispatites su, din doxa su kathos ipinando.
Christeo Theos, lead us to You have created man in according to your image and likeness and adorned him with all the gifts of your grace. You give wisdom and understanding to the one who asks, and you overlook not the sin, but have set repentance as the way of salvation. You have granted us your humble and unworthy service to stand even at this hour before the glory of your holy altar of sacrifice, and to offer to you due worship and praise. Master, accept the presiding and also from the lips of us sinners, and visit us in your goodness. Forgive all our voluntary and involuntary transgressions. Sanctify our souls and bodies, and grant that we may worship you in holiness all the days of our lives. Through the intercessions of the holy Theotokos and of all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages. For you, our God, are holy, and to you we offer glory. To the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Now and forever, and to the ages of ages.
More sure. You will do well to pay attention to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart.
Peace be to you, the reader.
Alleluia, 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 in the eighth tone.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Christ is in our midst.
He is the only show.
My beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, how is it that I'm going to even give you a snippet of what this feast will mean to us? For there is so much packed in here, it's really hard to recount. Metropolitan Maximus, our former metropolitan, loved this feast so much that whenever we're going to have a new camp, he was going to call it Camp Mount Tabor. That's like, you know, he just absolutely loved this feast. And he spoke about it with such great joy. And he talked about a lot of conjunction with this. But most of the time, he just really talked about getting up the mountain. You know, he just said, we have to get up the mountain. Not all the disciples made it. You know, nine of them were left behind. And he just said, we got to get up that mountain. All of them eventually were going to have the opportunity to go up the mountain, but only three initially were taken. And, you know, we can, you know, talk about those three. I mentioned it last night, that, you know, prefigurement of the Trinity for sure, but more than likely it was because they represent all of humanity, because those were the three sons of, Noah had three sons. And through three children, all of humanity came forth. And therefore, Jesus took three to represent that he was taking all of us. That he was taking our whole soul, our whole humanity up there. He didn't have to take all 12, and of course we heard from Santa from the Syrian. Why? Because there was a traitor, and Jesus knew it. And therefore, out of mercy, he left Judas, not by himself, but with a company of others. But the really interesting part of this is, for me, is how it happens to come on August 6th. Why August 6th? I mean, if we know from the tradition of the church, this happened when? What did I say? What did we say last night? This is supposed to happen at what time? Right before Jesus does what? He's right before his crucifixion. So why don't we do this during Lent? You know, this is supposed to happen. This is supposed to happen during the Feast of Great Lent, right? But we can't have this great feast during Great Lent. We already know that. We can't celebrate St. George during Great Lent. We have to move St. George outside of Pascha so that we can celebrate it appropriately. How is it that we're going to take this great feast and put it inside Great Lent? We can't do it. The church would not have us. And we can say about Evangelius Vos all we want, but Evangelius Vos, you know, it's one of those feasts that had to be there because of its proximity. There was no good place to put it. You know? Because the church placed it where? 9 months before Christmas. That's how it came to be. Christmas eventually became December 25th. That's not always when it was celebrated, but eventually when it was celebrated on December 25th, all of a sudden they said, wait a second, we gotta celebrate, you know, the Feast of Evangelius Vos, of Annunciation. So we used terrestrial time to do it, and that's okay. We placed it 9 months before, showing that Jesus was a human in every way, in every respect. He didn't have a quick, you know, pregnancy in the womb of the Virgin. His conception and pregnancy in the womb of the Virgin was just like any other humans. So that's why it happens to be within Lent. But they moved it. So why August 6th? What's so arbitrary about August 6th? Well, again, we use terrestrial time. What happens 40 days from now? What happens? What's the feast day 40 days from today? Say it. That's right. And the exaltation of the cross. Just about 40 days from today is the feast day of the lifting up of the cross. We could put it 40 days before the crucifixion, so we put it 40 days before the next best feast of the church. So it has a date. So it has a time. And we know on the feast of the exaltation of the cross, what gospel do we read? We read the gospel of Jesus' crucifixion. The gospel that we read about his passion, about his suffering, about his betrayal, about what he endured for us. We are reminded. The church doesn't beat our heads with it, but once in a while during the course of the year, we're reminded of what Jesus did for us. The whole of Holy Week for sure, during Lent on the feast day of the veneration of the cross. And then once again, we hear it again on the feast of the exaltation of the cross of Jesus. And then we hear it in the Sundays prior to and before. And we're reminded of it. You know, when Simeon grabs Jesus from from the Panagia and says the sword is going to pierce your soul, we're reminded of the cross. But it's, you know, you can't escape it. No matter what you do, the cross will find you. Right? That's what it is. And it's not supposed to haunt us. The cross is not supposed to haunt us. It's supposed to be a gentle reminder. It's supposed to grant us strength. Thy rod and thy staff, in Psalm 22, we are reminded, thy rod and thy staff have comforted me. Right? Thy rod and thy staff, two pieces of wood placed together, ruling in the Old Testament, another prefigurement of the cross. Letting us understand, it's supposed to be a comfort. It's supposed to be a solace, the cross. When Jesus is telling his apostles, and they finally see him for who he is, on Mount Tabor, you can imagine their brains were going nuts. We knew he was a good teacher. We knew the works of God were in him. But oh my Lord, in the most literal sense, they were saying. Peter lost his brain. Right? He's up there on the mountain going, I'm going to keep you guys up here. We're going to make one for Moses. We're going to make one for Elijah. We're going to make one for you. Stay here. We're going to be with you forever. And it even says in the scripture. I mean, they even took time in the scripture to tell us he did not know what he was saying. I mean, how many times does it say in scripture the guy didn't know what he was talking about? The gospel writer actually took time to let us know that. But this is it clearly. Because why? Why didn't Peter know what he was talking about? Because what were Moses and Elijah discussing with Christ? Though it's not a conversation we wanted to be with. Right? What were they discussing? They were talking about his passion. They were talking about everything that he was going to have to endure. They were reminding him of what he already knew, which was 40 days from now, you're going to make the ultimate sacrifice. The continuation of the ultimate sacrifice that you have already been making. And therefore, the news of who Jesus really is, as he's pulling back the veil of his humanity, so as much as they are able, they saw Christ, they saw God. That news had to be kept secret. But because again, like Judas, if word got out, the Jews were now even more accountable for the death not only of a man, but putting to death their God incarnate. Can you even imagine if they would have known who Jesus really was? To what end they would have been accountable. I know. It had to be secret who Jesus was. It had to be, you know, that portion of who he was. Until it came time for it to be revealed. But the real cool part of all of this, not, you know, like this isn't already really amazing, life changing. The really cool part is the mountain. Because it's just there. It just kind of stands there. And it acts as the method by which Christ can create this time. Now, I'm not exactly sure where the other nine disciples were. They couldn't have been that far. I can't imagine how this could have been hidden from the other nine if they weren't that far off. How is it that Moses and Elijah could have appeared on top of a mountain and anyone at the bottom would have seen a cloud just come out of nowhere and this bright light that's knocking the apostles down? How is that? You know, how could that have just been gone unnoticed by anyone that could happen to have been around? And that's where the mountain comes in. The mountain is so significant in our lives. Remember what Jesus does with the mountain after he feeds the 5,000. He goes and finds time with God. And where does he go? Up the mountain. He goes and finds that alone time. It is no secret, it is no joke, it is no coincidence that when he is revealing himself to his apostles, he is up a mountain. In other words, they are alone. That's what that means. It's them alone with God. Whether they truly physically were alone, I've never been to Mount Tabor, I cannot tell you how high it is. But I can tell you, if I'm at the base of that mountain, I can see the top. It's not that, I don't believe it's that big where, you can't see the top. So if I'm at the base of that mountain, like the apostles probably were, how could that sight have been invisible to them? Unless the mountain is a mountain in two senses. Number one, the physical one. And number two, the spiritual one. The one that we have to go to. We all need our mountain. We all need our fig tree. We all need our closet. We all need our time to be with God. If we don't get it, we will never know it. We will never know God unless we go up our mountain. Unless we ascend up the mountain. Because up that mountain, we have an experience. An experience of the uncreated light of our Lord. Now that's what Metropolitan Maximus was talking about whenever he was talking about all those years ago. Because he was talking about it for years. But when he came back from Jerusalem, after having seen the uncreated light that comes down on Pascha, and having placed his right hand in it, when he came back from that trip, when he went in whatever it was, 1996, 1997, you could tell he had just been up the mountain. Right? You could tell. You could see it. You could hear it in his voice. You could see it in his step. You could understand it in everything that he said. Of course, the ones that you could hear. But when you would sit with him and he would talk to you about that experience, something other happened. Something else wonderful happened. He took me up the mountain. And anyone that sat with him, he took you up the mountain with him as well. We all have to get up. We all have to ascend. And we have to understand that up that mountain is struggle, suffering, sacrifice, persecution. It's all up there. That's what Moses and Elijah are talking with Christ. It's all up that mountain. Both the preparation for it and the experience of it. It's all up there. Have to go. We're being asked to go. Or we're not being coerced, we're being asked. So today, when Christ is transfigured before his disciples and apostles, we too have the opportunity to change, to transfigure ourselves as we go up this mountain of silence, of solace, of comfort. Of true of enlightenment. As we ascend that mountain, we too have the opportunity to experience what God truly has for us, which is a life of a little bit of sacrifice and struggle, for sure. But it is a walk and a step that leads us to the uncreated light, that irresistible joy and warmth and comfort that is in Christ. It's within our reach. It's not outside of our reach. It's within our grasp. It's within our grasp today and always. It's up to us to reach out and grab it. And not with one finger or a couple fingers, with both hands. To hold on to it and never let it go. Amen. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please let us rise and we will continue our Bible. Again and again, peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
We forever into the ages of ages.
Yeah.
us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Deliverance from all affliction, wrath, anger, and necessity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Oh,
shed for you and for many for the remission of sin.
Life to Christ our God.
Ooh, 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 ooh.
Let us bow our heads unto the Lord. We give thanks to you, invisible King, who by your boundless power fashioned the universe into the multitude of your mercy, draw all things from nothing into being, look down from heaven, O Master, on those who have bowed their heads before you. They have not bowed before flesh and blood, but before you, the awesome God. Therefore, O Master, pursue the beneficial for us all, whatever lies ahead, according to the need of each. Sail with those who sail, travel with those who travel, heal the sick, petition of our souls and bodies. Through the grace, compassion, and love for mankind of your only begotten Son, with whom you are blessed, together with your all holy, good, and life-creating Spirit, now and forever, to the ages of ages.
Thank you. Thank you.
your immortal heavenly life-giving awesome mysteries of Christ, let us worthily give thanks unto the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Having prayed for a perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless day, let us commend ourselves one another and our whole life to Christ our God. You have made us worthy of your heavenly and immortal mysteries. Make straight our path, fortify us as your fear, guard our life, and secure our steps through the prayers and supplications of the glorious Theotokos and of the Virgin Mary and of all your saints. For you are our sanctification, and to you we ascribe glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever to the ages of ages.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, bless those who bless you and sanctify those who put their trust in you. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Protect the whole body of your church. Sanctify those who love the beauty of your house. Glorify them in return by your divine power. And forsake us not who have set our hope in you. Grant peace to your world, to your churches, to the clergy, to our civic leaders, to the armed forces, and to all your people. For every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from you, the Father of lights. To you we give glory, thanksgiving, and worship, to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever, and to the ages of ages. We have the blessed grapes from last night. We have now brought out again. So it is our joy to do that and to distribute those as well. And we will have the prayers read at this time. When you've had your human life apart with life, mysterious gifts, you can give praise and your thanks to God. Say the following prayer and soul, glory to your God, glory to your God, hail to your God.
Thank you, Lord, my God, that thou hast undertaken this in thy hand, made me worthy of the good of our ministries, I thank thee, that thou hast forgiven me. Although I am not worthy to receive, I hear of heaven the gifts of the Holy Master, and I have blessed for our sake. Grant to us these also by the great ministry for the world, and the sanctification of all souls and bodies. Let these be.
Well,
presence of all people, a light of light of Gentiles, the glory of your people Israel. Spotless will be commanded by the Holy Spirit for the apostles.